Today I'm building a new video editing PC. I'm getting increasingly jealous of everyone's new Ryzen builds, so I want to do one of my own, but using the new B550 boards, and I want to see how it impacts my DaVinci Resolve performance. Let's get undone.
Gerald Undone. He's crazy.
What's happening, everybody? I'm Gerald Undone, and I'm never going to financially recover from this. So let's go over the parts for this build, which were all supplied by Gigabyte AORUS, so thanks to them for that. I told them I wanted to do a Ryzen 9 build, and they sent pretty much all of this over, except for the case. I've got a Fractal Define R6 sitting on the floor for that. Let's start with the power supply so I can ground myself. Okay, like I said, let's start with the power supply. By the way, for those of you that are into pronunciation, I've heard other people say AORUS for this line, and so I asked Gigabyte myself because I like that kind of stuff, and they said that it's AORUS like the Egyptian Horus. So if you're like me and you like pronunciation stuff, that's the origin, and they're going for AORUS with this one. Okay, let's get the power supply out here. Now, power supplies aren't something that I've ever really attributed to Gigabyte before. Not really much in the way of frills, but it's got sort of a nice aesthetic to it. Big fan, fully modular, whatever. 750 watts. Okay, so I've got that plugged in, and now I'm gonna ground myself. And while I ground myself, I'd like to take a minute to tell you about today's sponsor, Storyblocks. Have you ever found yourself in a situation where you could really use some footage, but shooting it yourself was either budgetarily or logistically unfeasible? Well, Storyblocks has you covered with an impressive collection of stock footage covering a wide range of subjects with unlimited downloads and 4K video. They're also amply supplied with backgrounds, overlays, and After Effects templates, and the interface is easy to use and navigate, and the clips are royalty-free for both personal and commercial use, so you can use them as much as you want, wherever you want. So if you think you could take advantage of a fantastic library of quality stock footage and effects, check out Storyblocks using the link in the description below. All right, now, probably don't need to do this for that long, so let's get to the featured piece of today's build, the B550 motherboard. Okay, so here it is, the B550 Master. A few things to note. So unlike the X570, this one no longer has a fan, which is pretty great. But you do lose a couple things. Not all of the slots are PCI Express 4.0. This one, the top one is, and it's a 16x slot. You can install all three NVMEs in here at PCI Express 4.0, but there are some trade-offs. If you install the one up here again, no consequences, and this one will still be 16x. But if you install them in here, then this 16x slot switches to an 8x 4.0 slot. Now these two PCI Express slots, although they are 16 like size, they're only x4 slots, and they're PCI Express 3.0. And if you use the bottom one, you lose your last two SATA ports. There's 6 SATA ports, so SATA port 4 and 5 will become inactive, and you only have 0, 1, 2, 3. But if you're just doing a straight build like I am, where it's going to be one graphics card, one NVMe, then everything's PCI Express 4.0, and that's good to go. This one actually has a Thunderbolt 3 header, which I don't think that the X570 did, but it doesn't have the USB-C front header. So that's kind of annoying because my case has a USB-C front port, and I'm not going to be able to connect it to this motherboard. I think on the X570 board, it was right here, and it's not there on this one. The input-output panel's pretty good, though. These are USB 2.0. We got 4 of those. Those ones, I think, are on the chipset. And then there's 2 USB 2.0s here that are on the CPU. Then we've got 5 USB 3.2 Gen 2. So they're all 10 gigabit USB Type A ports. And then also a USB Type C port, also 3.2 Gen 2, 10 gigabit. And then there's a 2.5 gig Ethernet port, which is a Realtek port, not Intel. Okay, so let's move on to the CPU. Now, with choosing the CPU, this is kind of what the whole purpose of this video was. So this is the Ryzen 9 3900X. And I considered a lot of different CPUs for this build. The original idea behind this build was sort of high-end video editing, but at the best value. Now, value can mean a lot of things, because you can do a value build at $500, at $1,000, whatever. So what I did is I looked at the synthetic benchmarks and divided them by the price of the different CPUs to see which one, for the benchmarks that are relevant to video editing, produces the best performance score per dollar. And shout out to Puget Systems or Puget Systems. They have a benchmarking tool that you can download and run for your different programs like Premiere Pro or DaVinci Resolve, and it'll give you kind of a synthetic score as to how good your computer is at those specific programs. And again, the 3900X seems to be a bit of a sweet spot there for bang for buck. Okay, so for memory, I've got the AORUS RGB memory. This is 3600 megahertz. This is CL18, and it's a 16 gig kit. Now, all this stuff obviously is provided, like I said, by Gigabyte AORUS, and you can't be too picky you know, with what you get supplied. But this is the only area that I would say I didn't love their selection. All the other hardware I really like from Gigabyte, and in some cases it's some of the best in class. And the RAM is probably good memory, it's just that I don't like the options that they have. So for instance, with this combination, I probably would have gone with a 3600 megahertz CL16, but this is CL18, I don't think you can get CL16. And you can't get it in 16 gig DIMMs, like a 32 gig kit. Since this is a new build, it would have been nice to put in, say, two 16 gig DIMMs, and then I can upgrade to 64 in the future if I want. But I can't do that with this current configuration without completely getting rid of the RAM and starting over from scratch. So again, it's probably good memory. I just wish that they would make 32 gig kits with two 16 gig DIMMs, and it would be nice if I could pay a little bit extra to get 3600 CL16 instead of 18, 19, 19, 39. But anyway, let's throw it in. It is nice looking though. Nice edges. Okay, the RAM is installed. Let's move on to the NVMe drive. Now, this is one thing that I'm pretty excited about, and again, goes back to what I was saying about Gigabyte being, you know, best in class in some cases with this. So this is one of the new Gen 4 NVMe SSDs. It's a 1 terabyte version. I haven't actually tested it yet, but it says that it can do like 5 gigabytes per second. Gigabytes, like 5,000 megabytes per second. Ooh, look at it. It's a little tiny little gold guy. Ooh, that's actually got quite a bit of weight to it. That heatsink is serious business. Okay, so for the cooler, we've got this AORUS liquid cooler 280, which is a 280 millimeters, so two 140 millimeters. So the plan is to stick it here on the front as an intake pulling in through, and I'll put the fans on the inside. But I am curious because if that's gonna be possible, because I saw this Linus live stream where he did like an all AORUS build, and he was having issues mounting the fans. It was like the fans could only be mounted in a certain way on the cooler. So let's take a look at that and see. This is what the problem that Linus was having. So there's sort of like a tall edge and a short edge, and both sides have that. So if you put it down this way, it can kind of like wobble. So this is gonna go down on the CPU and this is gonna be over here at the front. And the reason why I'm doing it that way, you can see with the hoses coming out to the right, is because in all of the manuals and everything, the hoses coming out to the right, and again on Linus's stream, I saw that he didn't put the hoses on the right at first, and the display that shows you the temperature, because there's like a on-screen display here that you can customize and put the temperature and stuff on it, it was upside down and they ended up turning it. Now I don't know if you can switch it in software, but I don't want to risk it. However, on the front box, they have the hoses coming out the bottom and it seems to work, so. I'm not sure, but I'll learn that obviously when we turn it on. On this side is the way I want the fans, and I want them blowing into the case, so I want them like this, which is their uneven side. And obviously I don't want the blades to actually have any contact on them. I really do feel like these fans were only meant to be installed the opposite way that I'm doing it, but I checked on the AORUS YouTube video where they talk about this actual product, and they have one of their radiators installed on the front with the fans on the inside in this exact array. Okay, so it's on and it seems pretty level and the fan spins fine. It's not like, you know, rubbing up against anything. So it seems like it should work. Like I said, I'm just a little bit concerned about that leakage of the air, but we'll see what the temps are like. So for the GPU, this one is not AORUS. This is still Gigabyte. This is their RTX 2080 Ti gaming OC. Now there is an AORUS RTX 2080 Ti, but it wasn't in stock at the time that I was doing this build, so they, you know, said what other GPUs you want, and obviously they have other ones too, like they have AORUS 2080 Supers and that kind of thing. But I wanted the 2080 Ti because I've been finding that I kind of run out of VRAM sometimes with Resolve, depending on which cameras I'm working with. And the 2080 Ti is really the only thing that you can get more VRAM out of with the current lineup without going to like the RTX Titan, which is absurd. This one definitely isn't cheap though either. I think it's like $1,300 US. So depending on the build and what you need, you can probably get away with, like I said, the 2080 Super. That might fit better with this board too, because then you can bifurcate down to 8x and probably still be okay on your PCI Express. But this card is fantastic. I popped it in my old system to run the same tests so I could see what was affected by just the GPU, and it cut my render time in half from the GTX 1080, And because of the new NVENC encoder in the 2000 series, it actually made the file even smaller, but with the same quality. I'm just gonna go put the finishing touches on this, like power supply and cable management. Then I will install Windows, overclock it, and then rerun all of my tests. And I'm also gonna edit this video up to this moment on it and see how it performs. Bye for now. Okay, so it's actually been closer to 2 weeks since I recorded that first segment. And as promised, I did edit up to that point on this machine, and I'm probably gonna edit this part here on this machine as well. And I've gotten the shot here so that we can both see it running, but also hear it, which I think is pretty good. And we can see from the gauge in there that it's idling around 32 degrees Celsius. I thought for overclocked 3900Xs, that's actually a pretty good result. Price-wise, I didn't mention it, but this rig all-in cost about 3,000 US. And that is pricier, a bit more than I would have wanted to spend otherwise. Like I said, a lot of the parts were actually supplied by Gigabyte, but I priced them out based on the parts that they provided. But if you were to build this yourself, I think that you could make a couple changes. If you don't need all that VRAM, you could go with the 2080 Super like we talked about, which is gonna trim, I don't know, $600-$700 off the budget. And then there's a couple other parts where you could probably make some changes based on whatever's on sale at the time. And I think you could probably get a similar build to this down to about $2,200 while still taking the key Gigabyte AORUS parts that I really liked. All right, so let's go over the results. So if you see, I think I'll probably just put my Excel document on the screen for you, and I have the same one here. If you look, we start all the way over at the 2600K. That's the Intel i7-2600K. That was my editing rig before 2018, before I rebuilt it. And that 2600K is coming up on, I think, close to 10 years old now, and it's still cooking, which is pretty impressive. Now, we can see there's obviously a big jump going from the 2600K to the 8700K, and I noticed a big jump in performance when making that change. But I did find that there still was a little bit of, like, lagginess if you started layering up the highly compressed video streams, so like H.264 and H.265. If you had multiple versions of them, even the 8700K overclocked would still be kind of a little bit chuggy in those segments. So then, moving over, we now have the stock. I did a stock and I did an overclock for the 3900X with the RTX 2080 Ti, this one here. And all these rigs, I think, are using pretty much the same RAM, by the way. Not the same speed. This is using faster RAM, but they're all, I think, on 32 gigs. The Resolve benchmark went way up from 750 to 1117. And I did notice, in terms of practical, that a lot of my complaints about multi-layered H.264 stuff being kind of sluggish is a lot less so with this machine. It's sometimes hard to sort of quantify how it feels to edit, but this machine does edit those compressed codecs smoother, and it was noticeable and did make my life a little bit easier. The Cinebench score went way up from 3709 for multi-threaded up to almost 7100. So that'll give you a pretty good indication of an overclocked 8700K versus a stock 3900X. My Cinebench score almost doubled. Now, the single-threaded task, I wasn't sure if it would go down comparing to the 8700K clocked higher at 4.6. But it actually, well, I guess 4.6, this one can go up to 4.6, but it wasn't in Cinebench. It was only going up to like 4.2, 4.3. But it still beat it by about 10 on the Cinebench single-threaded. So I'm not losing any single-threaded performance. So that's a win-win there. But then I overclocked this system in three ways. I overclocked the graphics card, I overclocked the CPU, and also with the Ryzen 9, there's this whole thing we had overclocked the Infinity Fabric or the SoC and also the memory. And I have some notes about that. Criticism on this motherboard, the B550 Master. It does not have a CMOS clear switch, which I noticed when I was having some struggles getting a stable overclock where sometimes it wasn't booting and I just wanted to clear it, that there's no easy way to do that. I had to short the CMOS clear jumper with like a screwdriver. So there is like a jumper for it, but there's no button on the back. That's something that I typically like to see, and this one doesn't have it, and I'm pretty sure the X570 does. That's something I didn't notice when I did the overview. Oh, by the way, before we go further on the overclocking, I said that I would let you know if that screen, if the actual what's being displayed can be rotated in software, and you can. You could also, so you could mount it any way you want it, with the hoses down, up, whatever, because you can always just switch the display in software, but the default display is with the hoses coming out to the right. So I didn't have to switch it or rotate it, but you can if you want. Don't worry about how you install it. Also, even if there is like some air leakage on the side with the way I mounted the fans, but I'm okay with the thermals. So it seems to be working if you put this cooler in a pull configuration with the wobbly fans on the inside in a vertical mount. It works. It seems to work adequately, and it's reasonably quiet. So I did put a custom fan curve in the software. You have to install two pieces of software, which I don't love. You need to install the AORUS engine and then RGBFusion if you want to customize the lights and the look and all that. There's also a tool in AORUS Engine that allows you to automatically overclock your GPU, which I've used in other programs like MSI Afterburner. I never found it really worked well. But in AORUS Engine, it actually did successfully, you know, ramp up the frequencies and test them against the power draw and the thermals and then come up with like an overclocking curve. And speaking of that overclock, so let's look at the overclocking benchmarks now. So this is overclocked to an all-core 4.3 gigahertz. And I was able to hit it at like 1.29 to 1.3 volts, which I thought was actually pretty good. We're keeping pretty good temps though, around 33 idle in here. I think the temperature in here is like 23, 24, so we're about 9 to 10 degrees over ambient. The Resolve benchmark was pretty much the same. We didn't really get a lot from overclocking on the Puget synthetic Resolve benchmark. So keep that in mind. If you're just using Resolve, you might not see a huge gain by overclocking, and you can probably just run this thing on auto and it'll be fine. As far as Cinebench, we did see an improvement from 7100 up to 7700, which I thought was pretty great. The single threaded was exactly the same because, like I said, I was only boosting on auto up to about 4.3. So now that I'm running on all core 4.3, it's the same score. The Octane bench went up just a little bit from 309 to 311. That's with overclocking the GPU. I don't think that overclocking the GPU, that it really made that big of a difference for Octane bench, but we did see a bigger result in 3D Mark. As far as the export, we did actually shave some time off our export though, from 345 down to 334. So overall, I'm actually happy with the overclock, even though it probably wasn't too necessary for Resolve, but it's stable, it's reasonably quiet. I'm still in that 40 dBA range, which I'm happy with, and it's working well. I'll turn it off now so that you can hear the difference between it on and off. Let it power down there. And I want to talk about one more thing that I'm not really going to be able to get into this video because I'm sure that we're already at the 20-minute mark or longer now. So there's a ground loop going on. So I have a USB audio interface that I plug in here. And when I was doing those tests, whether it be like a GPU test or whatever, I can actually hear the GPU through my studio monitors. If I move the mouse around, I can hear like weird little, you know, EMI interference through the monitors. Just like inner computer sounds are coming through my monitor speakers. And it's because there's a ground loop. The monitor, this took a really long time. That's one of the reasons why it's like 2 weeks later. But thanks to my Discord group for helping me troubleshoot this. Rop again was in on it, Samoth, Nil4K, Tazy, you guys are great. We eventually got the multimeter out and started probing things and realized that the motherboard isn't going to ground the same way that the case and power supply are. It's doing some other route for the ground. So we end up with a ground loop. These computers, they generate a lot of electromagnetic sounds. But when there's a ground loop, it can get in there and you can hear it through your monitor speakers. Now, in the meantime, there is a solution that I have, which I bought on Amazon. It's like, it was 80 bucks Canadian, so probably like 50 US. And it's basically a little USB dongle that you can plug into the USB port, and then you can provide separate power to it. Plug that into the power bar, the same one that the studio monitors and the computer and everything are on, and then plug this in. And now this USB port will have the same ground, thus killing the ground loop. And when I plug my audio interface into this, it was fine and the sounds went away. So I still have some more testing to do, but luckily Gigabyte's been behind me all the way on this, and hopefully they're gonna send me some more boards, another B550 board, and maybe an X570 board, so I can use those to determine whether it's just my board that's defective or whether all the B550s ground differently, which is something that you should be aware of if you use a USB audio interface like me. But if you're somebody that just uses the audio jacks on the back of the motherboard, little 3.5 millimeters, you don't have to worry about that. One, they're not generally subject to the ground loop because it's not a separate power thing, but also they seem to have extra capacitors and they're well shielded, so there was no sounds coming through those jacks, only USB audio interfaces. I'm definitely happy overall, just want to figure out that ground loop thing, so definitely stay tuned for that follow-up video, and hopefully I will get the results back on that soon. But that's going to be it for me. I hope you found this video entertaining, or at least helpful, and if you did, make sure you leave it the old thumbs up and consider subscribing if you haven't already. But if you did not find this video helpful or entertaining, try setting the playback speed to 75%. Alright, I'm done.